All right, guys. My name's Dennis, and thanks for making it out to the Sea Starting class here at the Garden Pool. I want to thank Danielle, Becky, and Linda. They're volunteers here at the Garden Pool as well. Thanks for helping us out with the class. And does everyone have a Seed Start guide, a paper handout? Okay. So I'm going to tell you how I start seeds. And I've had pretty good luck starting seeds. When we do tours, that's one thing I notice is people always say, holy cow, look at all these seeds. How do you do that? So that's why we're doing this class today. Kind of the heart of my seed start operation. It's called the 10-20 tray. All right, it's like 10 inches by 20 inches. They just call them 10-20 trays, 10-20 flats. They're really like 11 by 21. It's kind of like buying a rug. You get a 6 by 9, but you take it home, it's a 5 by 8. So, but there's different kinds of 10-20 trays. I like to get mine at the hydroponic stores because they're a lot thicker than the ones you get at the box stores. And if you get the thin ones, they're probably only good for a couple sets of starts. So, however, let's see, can you find my number tray? All the numbers on it. Might be in there, I'm not sure where it's at. So I always get the thicker ones, and most of the hydroponic stores around here all get it from the same manufacturer. So we have a whole stack of them here. And, they're all designed to take the inserts. Now this is a 72 cell insert, so I can start 72 plants with this. So when my 10-20 trays bite the dust, eventually you'll get holes in it. You know, if you take it up to the light, that's how I do it. If I take it up to the light and I can see holes, or if you accidentally crack it, it's bit the dust. So what I do is I write numbers on the side, okay? And then, take it, bam, put it on your old, on your new 10-20 tray, then you know what row is numbered. So I could have hundreds of rows, and I know every single one of them is. And these guys too, so. But, these things fall out. My kids go like this. So they haven't figured out how to foil my numbering system yet. So when I do use these little T markers, what I do is I write what it is and then the date that I started them. Because you have that little guide there that tells you how long your typical seeds are going to take to germinate. So if it's supposed to germinate in 2 weeks and I look at the date and it was 4 weeks ago, might be bad seeds. So, or something bad happened. Never know. But make sure you mark everything because you'll forget. Trust me, I forget all the time. So I'm like, what is this? I don't know, I'll wait till I get fruit on it or something like that. So mark it and you won't forget it. Now, just like the 10-20 trays themselves, these come in different qualities. The kinds I've seen at the box stores over here, you can just crumble them. And you'll probably only get a couple uses. This is really rigid. So expect to pay a couple bucks for these and a couple bucks for these. So, but then again, you'll begin to be able to use them again and again and again. So this is what I use the most. It's a 72 cell starter. I like it because the plugs are a great size to put in a garden. I'm a garden grower. I don't grow a whole lot in pots, so I don't like to pot things up. But this one's a 50 cell starter, okay? The typical sizes are you have 38 cells, which are a lot larger, 50 cells, 72s, and then they even have 98 cells. And those just remind me of like marker punches. You know, you can fit a lot of plants in those things. But I kind of came up with a neat way to figure out how tall before you transplant them here, okay? So if you look at these, they're about an inch and a half. So just add it up and you come up with the diameter, which is 6 inches. So when they're about 6 inches tall, you want to transplant them. And you can do that the same with starter pots and everything like that. It's my diameter transplant. So it seems to work pretty good. But not all plants are equal. some of them have faster growing roots than others, so you can just pick it up and look. If the roots are really long, go ahead and get them out of there, because it'll be real hard to pull them out without ripping the roots. The roots are the most sensitive part of the plant, period. But 10-20 trays are really handy because they're like perfect size to grip and hold. So that's why they use them, and they're standard. Every greenhouse you go to pretty much uses these. So they have different attachments. These are humidity domes. They close and open. Usually if you want humidity, I'll leave one open, one closed. Get on top like that. If you want to, you can put a light on top. If you don't have a big setup, just a single light like that. Keeps the moisture really good. So it's good for tomatoes and stuff like that. They like the humidity. But I don't use them too often. But they also have inserts that'll fit like different sized pots. You know, really handy. You can get the peat pots. But I'm not a big fan of peat. This is peat. Peat. Okay. This stuff is made out of peat. And it's kind of sad. It's okay, grow medium, not the best. You can compress it and make cool things like this. You stick them, it's OMRI listed, organic, whatever. But you could have a 2,000-year-old bog and harvest the whole thing in a week. So the bogs are shrinking. So if you've ever been to a bog, they're real pretty. They have flowers and kind of mossy to step around, and it's an ecosystem, and they're destroying it for this stuff. So what we use, we use coconut. This is our grow medium. And this coconut, we got them from Sri Lanka. It's where 90% of all coconut comes from on the planet. And this is post-harvest leftover waste. So if we don't use it, it's gonna end up in the landfills. So the bogs that you get the peat moss from, it's actually a huge carbon sink. So it holds a lot of carbon dioxide there. So when you harvest that stuff, you release it into the air. So this is a way better product to use for several reasons. So, could you do me a favor and give me a bucket full of water?
Oh, okay.
Yeah. Not a full one, a 2.5 gallon or so. And we have pens if anyone wants to take notes, if anyone needs pens. Of course, we're going to have the video online, so hopefully it'll come out pretty good. But let's kind of back up. We'll go onto the grow medium here in a minute. Let's talk about lighting. These are the kind of lights I use. It's a special color. As you can see, they're really bright and they're kind of bluish. And they're T5 fluorescent lights. And you want 1-2 footer for every tray you have. And you want to put them as close to the plants as you can. Now you can use those clamp lights too, like just get a CFL squiggle bulb, as long as they're a daylight blue color, 6500K is what it is. It's weird, light comes in color temperature. You know, the typical bulbs are more yellow reddish looking. These are bluish color light. It simulates springtime. So what we have to do though is you flip those trays around every day, because you don't want all of them to bend towards the light. So every day you flip them the other way, that way they don't stretch and permanently bend. So now, it's okay. Now, this is my seed starting table. I like it, it's nice and tall. I can fit a couple trays on here and a bucket. So, these are cucumbers, okay? And now, I keep them under the lights until I think they're ready to transplant. The reason why I keep them under the lights is it's not too intense like our sun is. If you keep them outside, for one thing, the birds are probably gonna eat it, and they'll probably just die. There's no way you can keep it watered fast enough. Coco coir is really absorbent, but it'll still dry out in the full-blown sun. So I keep them under the lights. You can stretch your days out to 18 hours. So instead of 8 hours of sun, it's gonna get 18 hours of sun. So use a timer or just turn it on and off regularly. And seeds don't need any nutrients, okay? With the seed starts. So you don't have to use any Miracle-Gro or anything like that. You'll probably burn your plants and probably kill it. So the first set of leaves that come up, that's called the cotyledon. And it's not a real leaf. This is basically where all the food is inside of a seed. Now, here's a seed, okay, it's kind of a cross section, and they usually have like a funny little dot right here. So a majority of the inside of the seed is two sections for most plants. It's the cotyledon, it's the pre-leaf. And then you have what's called the embryo, which is the first part of the plant that sticks up and goes up to the ground, and the other part of the roots that develop that way. So this is packed full of nutrients. You don't have to give it anything until you start to get more leaves. Once you get more real leaves, then you dilute water-based, like Miracle-Gro, foliar feed, some organic stuff, but you want to dilute it a third. Most books will tell you a half. To me, that's too much. Dilute it a third. It's very little nutrients. So, but once these guys are a couple more inches, then I'll go and transplant them. But I'm just gonna check the roots now. See, they're just barely poking out. So when you wait for them to get to the right size for the cell size, then the roots kind of keep it together. So when you pull it out, it doesn't just fall apart. Kind of holds it together. And you don't want to pull them out until they're big enough, the roots are big enough to take a transplant. So, neat thing about cocoa coir is you can use it for dirt gardening, or you can use it for soilless gardening like aquaponics or hydroponics, so we use it for everything. Now, it's really light stuff. So this is the clay, this is like equal. This is probably maybe 10 pounds heavier than this, and I thought clay was really light, but it's not compared to this. And it's sterile. So this is the brown coir. There's two types of coir, white coir and brown coir. We have the brown coir, and the size we use are about the same size as our pellets. So you can use it for seed start, or you can use it as a grow medium, or you can use it for mulch. But we like it for seed starts because of its antimicrobial properties, its antibacterial properties, its antifungal properties. It's really neat. Basically, when you put a seed in a tray, and I'll just show you how I do it. First of all, I fill up the cell most of the way. I leave it a quarter inch down, and it's real loose. So I kind of just sprinkle it in here, okay? And when you got half inch, quarter inch to go, I put my seed in there. If you want, you can soak your seed overnight. I don't, usually, because this core holds the moisture really well. Put the seeds on there, and then I just sprinkle the cocoa on the top to fill it up. That's how I do it. I used to use perlite vermiculite, a little bit of soil at first, perlite vermiculite on top, because perlite vermiculite's inert, non-organic, doesn't have bacteria in it, but the core is even better. It has the same absorbent properties, and it has a little bit of micronutrients in it too, which is great. So it's like, how do you use that stuff? Now, this is what a lot of people buy if you go to get seed start mix. It says it right there, seed starting mix. You think this stuff is great, but this is peat moss. Can you grab me a scissors, please? And I feel shameful even buying this stuff because I know they destroyed some ecosystem somewhere. But it's what they tell you to use, and I'll show you why I don't use it. So it's actually mixed. It looks like it has a little bit of perlite in it, but it's real light stuff, which is good. You want light stuff?
Sure.
So
here.
So I'll put it like that full, okay? Now, I'm gonna try to mix it with water, and it doesn't really mix at all. It just floats. And I'm serious, if I take it, it looks like it's wet, and I open it up and it's dry in the middle. So, I don't like this stuff. At first I used to have to mix vermiculite with it to make it more absorbent, or you can mix it with core, or you can just use core. So now on, I'm just going to use core. But when you get the bricks, this is how they come. You know, they'll come wrapped up. This is how we have ours. It has a nice tall bag. This is 6 mil, the same stuff they recommend traditionally to make greenhouses out of. It's recyclable too. But what you do is you just, so, just put it with some water in it. It absorbs. It's very super absorbent stuff. The neat thing when you use it as mulch is you only have to mulch once a year because it takes longer to break down. The reason why you can use coconut as a grow medium is because it doesn't break down in water. Everything else does. If you use bark, it'll eventually turn into ammonia. All right, now, if I can get Danielle to go ahead and try to press this one. I'll let you work that. Break it up. So she's gonna break up that cocoa brick, all right? Now, in the bag, you only have to take out as much as you need. All right, that's why the bags are really handy, because unless you do a lot like I do, or you're using it for grow medium, you only want a little bit of a time. So it actually expands 6 times in size. So think about 6 of those bricks. That's kind of the area we're talking about. So. So just going back, say this is 1/4 inch down. I put my seeds on it. So I put my seeds down and I just go and I cover them. And just try to get it nice and level. So our seeds are in there and we're just covering them. Basically, we're just trying to keep the light off of it. That's all we're really trying to do. Now, the cool thing about coco coir, another one, is it doesn't grow algae on top, which if you use perlite or even soil, it can grow algae on top. So it doesn't have any of this. Now, a lot of people use a damping rod like this. I just use my thumb. Go and you want to actually push it down. So, but it needs water. So when I first started, I do just about a whole gallon in here and I pour it in the tray and let it wick up. So I'm going to pour a whole gallon and that's really full. And I don't water it again until it dries out. And when it dries out, I put a 1/2 gallon of water in there. And that's all that tray needs. So I like these, I can just dump it in the barrel. So when I water, I don't use tap water because tap water has chlorine. No matter where you live, I don't care. Unless you have algae in your water, your tap water has chlorine in it. That's bad for plants. So if you want, fill up a nice jug the night before, let all the chlorine evaporate, and then just use it tomorrow. Okay? Personally, I use pond water because it has good nutrients in it. If not, the chlorine is a salt and it will stay in your grow medium. So if you've ever seen any potted plant look brown on the leaves, that's from chlorine. So most of like your loquats and really sensitive plants, avocados, they're brown leaves, that's from chlorinated water. So you don't want it for your seeds. And then I spray the top with just the nice mist. So the core is really wet. It's totally soaking in that water there. I spray the top and then I push it down. And the reason why you're pushing it down is because you want to make sure that seed has total contact with the soil so it knows it's buried and not just loose laying on the ground. You don't want any sunlight to hit it. Now, if you want these suckers to sprout, put them in some heat. Okay, so what I do is I put them where they're gonna get a little bit of sunlight. Now you don't want so much heat that it's gonna warp your tray. So kind of put it on the edge of where your sun hits. You want these to be warm. You want the mat to be like 80 degrees if you want it to sprout. So in the wintertime, they sell at the nursery stores 10-20 mat warmers. They fit underneath. They're about that thick. They have a little heating element. You plug it in, and it keeps it heated, and they sprout. If the soil's not the right temperature for when the plant knows it should grow, it's not going to start. So we like to trick Mother Nature. We like to start early, right? So we can start it indoors where it's maybe not the right temperature, but put it by a sunny window. It'll get the sunlight and heat up that tray, and it should sprout. So, and like I said, you want the tray to dry out, but not completely. You want it to be dry, but not bone dry. So what I do is I just peek at the tray underneath, and if it looks like there's just barely a little bit of water, I'll go ahead and water it again. You don't want it to be bone dry. And then, like I said, with just a half a gallon of water, it fills it up about halfway. And then it just wicks. If you try to water it on top, you're going to kill your little babies. So. And Danielle has got a whole bunch of coconut. Let's dump it out of here. Compress more. But this is what I like to use to put my 10-20 trays on. You can pick them up at any of the big box stores, even Harbor Freight has them. Usually get them for about $40. And it has a nice cover for in the wintertime. It makes a little greenhouse, a little cold frame. You can take the shelves off. Like if you look on this one on the bottom, I have some nice tall plants growing, so I took one shelf off. And I hang the lights on here. It's like perfect. The lights you get will all come with S-hooks, and it'll fit right here on this wire. So when we do builds and set people up with greenhouses, we'll set up a light here, light here, light here, and they can do hundreds of plants. It's amazing. So, you know, growing your own food saves you money, but if you're buying plant starts at the nursery, it kind of defeats the purpose. If you think about it, one little tray of a six starts of whatever plant might cost $3, but hey, you can buy a bag of seeds that probably has 200. Use these guys and you'll get it. But let's back up a bit to when we put the seeds in here. I don't plant one seed ever because my luck, that seed's not going to grow and then we have a whole wasted space. So what I do is if the seeds are pretty good, like sunflowers, those suckers grow pretty good. I'll probably put three in them per cell. Okay, and then when they sprout and they're about time for transplant, I'll look at the one, the two that look the weakest, and I'll take them out. That way I get the healthiest plant, and you know you have 72 plants here, you know. So that's what I do. Like even with Moringa, it's a very healthy plant, but I always plant three per pot every time. And then I pick the healthiest one. So. Now, some plants take longer to sprout than others. The guy that you guys have is from the University of Arizona Extension Office, and every state in America has an extension office, and that's why where you find the best information for your climate, and it tells you most of the majority of crops. Now, some things take longer than others, so you just need to know the germination. That way you don't give up on them. Like sorghum, for example. If we start sorghum, because it's going to take 4 weeks before that sucker sprouts. That's a long time for seeds. So unless you know that, you'll probably dump that out. So you might start going in your compost bin or something. So this is one brick. It's almost filled up this whole kiddie pool. And it's not soaking wet. This is about perfect. It's not crumbly. It's not dry, blown in the wind. You want it nice and, you know, just damp for the touch to use, but not soaking at all. This is perfect. Now, if you want, you can bag that up, put it in one of those big leaf trash can bags, and it's okay. It might dry out a little bit and poke some holes in it, but it's okay to hold the moisture because, like I said, it won't get gross with the water, which is neat. You can't do that with a whole lot of other things. So.
I noticed that you've just put your hose in there and to fill that up. You were talking about the chlorine issue before. Uh-huh. Do you have a chlorine filter on your hoses? What do you worry about?
Usually we'll use pond water.
Okay.
But I'm out there. This is like my little bucket I use all the time. It's big enough for me. I can just dump down in my... I have that 55-gallon barrel. Yeah. I just dump it in there, pull up, it's full. Air comes out here, I dump it up. Use it as little bit at a time. This, we're trying to do it all at once, right. But unless we're doing a whole lot, we always use the pond water because, yeah, you're right, that can stay in the grow medium itself.
Okay.
But we've had this tested to make sure it's salt-free. And if you're gonna buy core, that's what you make sure you look for. It comes from Sri Lanka, it's an island. They might use the ocean water to help process this stuff. So if it's horticultural grade, it'll be 99% salt free. As long as it's real cocoa core, that's all you have to worry about. So you'll have a hard time finding this size. It's about the size of our hydrogen cubes. And most seed start is very fine stuff, almost like sawdust. I don't like that because water can't move through it. It doesn't have enough aeration in it. So, but like I said, here we go. For these cucumbers, once they're a couple inches taller, I can go ahead and plant it in the dirt or plant it in the soilless grow medium, whatever I want to do. So. Now, do we have any questions?
What does water drip on that now?
They're pretty good. Doesn't drip a whole lot. That's why I like to fill them like this.
No, I mean from the top it falls on.
Mm-hmm. It's okay, it's all covered. It can only go in a couple places. I haven't had any problems so far. So, but that's, then again, I don't spray with a hose like that. I fill these trays, and these trays really contain the water. I don't ever put anything on here unless I have a tray, if I have a light on there. Because that could be a danger. I've known people burn stuff down doing stuff like that. Of course, their system leaked and no one was there. It was a store. You know, they had a nice little setup display greenhouse and the thing burned down. But, yeah, it's okay. As long as you're not dripping water.
That light, now, you said it was what?
This is a T5 fluorescent. They're not the real thick ones like you have at home. They're about as thick as my thumb. T5. And they're very bright. It's a high output. So each bulb, 2 footer, is about 1,300 lumens, which is equivalent to 1,300 candles. So they're very bright bulbs, and they have like a 20,000 hour life on them, which is fantastic. So I leave them on at nighttime. If you drive by my house at night, you'll see my side all lit up. So that's what's happening. I'm sitting here with the seed starts. So even if, like Linda brought over some blackberry cuttings, I threw those under the lights. And it kicked up real quick, because you're extending the day, you're extending the amount of photosynthesis energy that the light's taking. And as long as you use the blue spectrum, they think it's springtime. So they think it's time to grow leaves. Plants have two modes, time to grow leaves and time to grow fruit. So when the fruit time is fall time, that's when you use the red color light, like the 2500K. But we always use, for seed start purposes, 6500K. Now, just make sure you don't use regular dirt in your compost to start your seeds, because that's not sterile at all. You can sterilize dirt though, believe it or not. Like, we would throw it in our sun oven, let it bake at 350, you know, until the whole thing is 350 degrees, and that dirt is sterile. So you can throw it in your oven the same way too. But really, 250 is temperature. You don't want to go too high because things can combust. 250 is as high as you need to go to sterilize dirt. But I like the cocoa core because it wicks. It doesn't compact. If you use regular dirt in this type of application and you try to feed it from the bottom, it'll sink down and compact, and the roots don't grow as fast. So. Yes?
The temperature in the summer, do you take it inside to germinate?
Yeah. I'll do them right here on the patio, because you just don't want the direct sunlight on it, period.
So 110 degrees, whatever. Mm-hmm. The temperature really doesn't matter.
Because the crop you're growing, that's the time of year it needs to be that really hot. So especially here, like our cantaloupes and all that type of hot weather crops, it needs to be hot. It might not germinate if it's 70 degrees in your house. So truth be told, a lot of times in the summertime I'll plant my seeds in the little greenhouse. It has a nice 40% shade over it. But you're going to spend more time with your seeds than you will with any other plant in your garden, because these guys dry out and you got to keep them watered, especially during summertime. There's nothing worse than spending 3 weeks on 72 plants. You forget to let it water it, it goes bone dry, and you come back and everything's all dead and you're like, ah. So, but that's really the name of the game, just keep them in water until they're ready to transplant. And if you follow the diameter rule, like I said, then you know when to do it. So
once they're ready for transplant, can you reuse the cocoa peat for a
yes.
new batch?
Yes, you can. Which has been great. It doesn't break up. So cocoa takes a long time to break down. Like I said, if you use it as mulch, instead of mulching twice a year, like normal people do with bark, you only mulch once a year because it takes twice as long to break down, even with microbes and worms going through it. So.
What type of seeds do you use?
What's that?
Any particular type of seeds?
That's a good question. The best place that we found to buy seeds is Baker Seeds. Baker Creek, yeah. RareSeeds.com, yeah.
What is it?
Baker Creek. She'll grab the catalog. We like it because it has a lot of different things. Native Seed Search is pretty good too. They're a non-profit. They have a lot of stuff. We got our sorghum originally from them, or in a roundabout way. So Native Seed Search, if you want some stuff that you know does well here in the desert, and they're a good non-profit, and Baker Creek Rare Seeds. So, I have a rule I follow when I grow. I let 10% of what I'm growing go to flower, go to seed. And then I harvest that, and then that's more than enough for the next couple of years. Like, let's say I have 10 broccoli. I'll let 2 of them go to seed, and then I'll probably have 6,000 seeds just from those 2 broccoli plants.
Thank you.
Do you need to do anything with... We're really, really new at this, so maybe this is an obvious question.
No.
Forgive me. When you let it go to seed like that and you harvest them, do you need to do anything to them before you...
You want to make sure they're completely dry.
Okay.
Bone dry if you're going to harvest seeds. If not, they'll get moldy in the bag. So once we harvest the seeds, this came from a birdhouse gourd. This is just one birdhouse gourd. That's a ton of seeds. We made sure it was totally bone dry, put it in the bag, then you want it nice and airtight. And what I do is I store all of our seeds in one of these bait and tackle boxes that are waterproof. You can take them fishing, drop them in the water, who cares? Because it keeps it airtight. And then just keep it out of the sun. And if you do those two things, keep it airtight, keep it out of the sun, 3 things, bone dry. And then your seeds can last like 5 to 10 years, believe it or not. So, yes?
I feel stupid asking this question.
There are no stupid questions.
I have an onion that I just really bought from grocery and I was just sticking in the dirt.
Uh-huh.
Cool. Okay, then I watched the flower, like, okay, what point is this seed to grow in the flower?
When half of the onion stalks have all fallen over, basically. It should be pretty bone dry by then. You know, when they brown out and yellow out, it looks like it's almost half dead. That's when the time. But you'll get a lot of cool seeds, and the seeds are nice size.
Yeah, they look flowery right now.
It looks like, onion blooms remind me of fireworks, the big bomb ones, really cool. So this is the Baker Creek heirloom seeds, and it has all different kinds of cool things. If you guys come here in the wintertime, we're growing like 10 different types of lettuce, and this has everything known to man. A long time ago, 100 years ago, we grew, depending on what region, that's different crops you grew. So when you went to Oregon, they grew different things than they grew down in Tennessee. Now, everybody grows mono agriculture crops.
What's the name of that?
This is Baker Creek Heirloom Seeds. It's rareseeds.com, all one word. And they'll send you a free catalog if you have an online catalog. But heirloom seeds have been around for 100 years usually, and they're very stable, so you know that the mama is going to look like the baby, is going to look like the grandparent or whatever. So they're easy to open pollinate to. They're easy to seed save. That's the cool thing about heirloom seeds. So that's why we do it. Now, not to say that some of the hybrid tomatoes and stuff like that aren't good in their own right, but you just don't know if it's genetically stable enough. So.
Can you pass the magazine around?
Yeah,
absolutely.
Yeah, take a look, just flip through that here. And let's see, speaking of seeds, we need the tickets and our bucket here.
Are you able to grow root vegetables in the cocoa peat in a aquaponic setting, like potatoes or onions, or do you do those in a separate grow bed?
Well, I haven't tried it, to be honest with you. I haven't tried it in cocoa, but we are growing sweet potatoes, and I have grown carrots in the hydroton.
Okay.
So I don't see why
kind
not.
Of, kind of hydroton shaped.
Sweet potatoes came out normal.
Okay.
The carrots look like a golf ball.
Yeah.
It's really funny, the dimples on the side. So.
Those lights, do you use them on the greenhouse inside the house or in the patio?
No, not necessary. The only supplement, on the patio. I use them on the patio.
So, throughout the day?
No. Unless they're getting good light. If they're in total darkness, like I have some back that's not getting sunshine, those are on during the day. So you
but
can
at night you
at night I turn them on. So here's a good trick. The only thing with the lights is it'll bring moths. And if anybody knows about growing things, moth lay caterpillars, right? So what I do is you use one of those bug zappers, right? Have it on a timer to kick on right after your lights turn off. Okay, then the moths go to that bug zapper because it's the only light source, and then you don't have them tomorrow. You just don't want to have these trays out in the full sun. You know, they're not meant to take the full sun. They won't last, they'll warp and all of that. So seed starting is really in the shade. If you think about like our bananas, our baby bananas, they're shaded from their parents. That's how vegetables and plants are meant to grow in Mother Nature. So that's what we have to do, provide them with shade and just enough light to grow successfully. But we can control the environment, we can control the amount of light they get, we can control the amount of water they get, and between those two variables we'll have hundreds of plants. So if we fill this whole thing up with 72 trays, it's a lot of plants. So.
Do you think it's better to do them outside as opposed to inside?
Personally, because I'm a floor guy, I like to keep my floor nice in my house. These will leak, you know, you'll spill some water, you'll get cocoa everywhere. But if you're really clean, I've seen some, Lane, you know, she starts wonderful tomatoes in her office with nice wood floors and stuff, but she's real careful. So it's all up to you. These lights, double fixtures, you're probably gonna pay about $50. Single fixtures, you can pick them up for about $20. Any other questions?
Mentioned blackberries. You got some blackberry seeds or starch or something? You started those or what?
Actually, we did cuttings. I'm kind of proud of them. I'm going to grab them. So. So Linda, she's our VP over there. She brought over some stems and they had some roots. And we didn't know if they were going to make it, but they sure look good now. They have new stems and everything. How long's this been?
It's been at least a month.
A month. And I kept them under the lights, the grow lights, and it helped them really bush out. Now that they're bushy, I'm gonna put them and let them get normal light so they'll know what time of season it is.
Are they thornless or?
These are thorny.
No,
we wanted
thorny.
Them, they're perimeter, around our perimeter fence.
Does it need full sunlight or shade?
These were in full sun, right?
Full sun, yep. Full sun.
So we do have some thornless variety. We planted some Navajo blackberries too. I have fruit for the neighbors planted all along my wall, but I don't want them hopping my fence, so I'll put the blackberries along the inside of my fence. But these should be no problem to propagate. That's kind of the fun thing. Like, we have these key apples. They're a real thorny West African apple shrub. They make apples like this, and you can clip them, and they grow from cuttings too, just like goji berries. So I seed start when I have to. I don't seed start a whole lot of tomatoes because I can just take cuttings, put them in aeroponics, 2 weeks, they've got roots and I can transplant. So I clone what I can most of the time because it's 3 months faster. But some things, it's not really right to clone because they have a cycle, a season. They only give their fruit when it's the right time of year and they know based on how much sunlight they get. So, oh yeah, here's a sweet potato. It's a sweet potato cutting and we've been cloning this guy for a couple years now. This is 2 weeks, maybe probably about 3 weeks now. 3 weeks in the aeroponics cloner. Now I can put them in the dirt carefully. Probably use cocoa core because I don't want to infect the roots, bacteria, and stuff like that. And it's ready to go. It'll start producing a tuber, and I'll harvest it when I want. I can take cuttings and, you know, the aeroponics machine we have, I can do like 8 of them at a time. So, well, between cloning with aeroponics and seed starting, There's no reason to ever buy plants.
You're using aeroponics to clone?
To clone.
And then you're transplanting them into your big grow beds?
Mm-hmm. Comes out pretty good. I did the tomatoes. I have them up on the rooftop now. Oh, I did have more trays to show you, but I just planted 240 plants up there. We have pipes zigzagging above our heads that empties back into our pond. It's like 4-inch pipe, and they have 2-inch. So in a month, you guys will drive by and see sunflowers and corn. It's going to look awesome up there. So we have more room up there than in our pool. But with this, I just take out the plugs, pop them up in the roof. I'm good to go. I used to use, like I said, a little bit of dirt and perlite vermiculite on the top, but then I'd have to rinse the roots when I put it into soilless medium, and I might have lost a third of them, which is heartbreaking when you spend weeks growing this stuff, and you probably harvested the seed, so. But coco coir has been a life-changing thing for us here. It's going to replace all of our clay. It's a lot lighter, and it's going to be our primary seed starting mix, and it's sustainable, so that's good stuff. We do big builds. You guys have seen some of the meetups. We'll have like huge grow beds this size, several of them. And if we would have took the clay, we would have needed a dump truck to fill those up. But I can just fill up the trunk of my Pontiac with those bricks, and we'll expand them on site, and there you go. And then they can use that for their seed start mix too. Pretty neat stuff.
Use that instead of hydroponics.
Yes. So it has nice flow. If you look at it, the cubes are about the right size. So we've even used it in shelf ponics. Full grow beds full of it. So, yes?
When it does break down in a year or two, does the sediment
get
after that?
Yeah, it will break down after a couple of years, but you're half the price of the clay, but it is reusable.
I assume then your worms are shut down on it?
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Because we use worms in all of our grow medium. So even though we don't use dirt, we still use the worms. And what the worms do is they eat the sludge that can accumulate. So just like soil, we use worms. So, but it'll take them a lot longer to break this stuff up. Coconuts are made to... I've only known one person who's sprouted a coconut, and they threw it in a canal for a month down in Florida, and then they took it out, and then it sprouted. Because coconuts are supposed to float away to go to another island, and they're made to sit in the water for a very long time, and they don't break up. So that's one of the neat things. The only other plant like that is really the redwood tree, you know, that has the same antimicrobial properties. So I think there are people in California making redwood-based, but that's not as sustainable as coconut. Those take things thousands of years to grow. So, but the aim of the game is keeping the bacteria and the fungus and the algae off your seeds until they start transplanting when they're the right height. That's really it. So it's an art, but it's an art that everybody can learn. Oh yeah, your tamper tool that you push down is also your moisture meter too. So stick that in the bottom of your tray if you feel moisture. If it feels dry, water it right away. Use a half a gallon. So. Any other questions?
Where do you buy the cocoa beans?
We got it from Sri Lanka. We got 1,000 pounds or more. It's crazy. They told us we got a half pallet. But you know, you think a pallet about that tall? Up here, this tall. So we have it. We got a lot of it in. We got it straight from Sri Lanka. So we had to have it tested. It's actually kind of a big thing. It took us a couple months to get it here. It's like a slow boat to China, from China.
So we can purchase it from you directly.
Yeah. So we have these bricks available for $15. And then it comes in the bag, and it's resealable too. So that's what we have here. And we also have a couple of these available for $35. Usually they're $40 at Harbor Freight. I think they're $40 at Lowe's too. If anyone is interested. But if not, check out the locally family-owned and operated hydroponic shops, small businesses. Support them. Any other questions? Okay, well, thanks for making it out to the seed starting class, guys. Appreciate it.